brought to you by Kim's Upholstery. I have to apologize for the delay this morning or this afternoon. We tried to go live both on YouTube and on Facebook, and Facebook for some reason was not allowing us to do that. So we are here on YouTube only today. So thank you for any of you that come in and join us. We encourage you to say hello. Let us know where you're viewing from. And during our live segment, we really encourage you to go ahead and ask any questions that you might have about upholstery projects. Now, if you are not a subscriber to our Kim's Upholstery YouTube channel, I invite you to go ahead and hit that subscribe icon that you will see there. And when you do that, you'll see this little bell icon. And if you click on that bell icon, every time we put content on YouTube, you'll get a notification. So you won't miss anything education-wise with us. So again, welcome to our show today. And we will be doing upholstery, but we're doing upholstery for windows. So this is actually what's called a cornice board, for those of you that might not be familiar with this. So this would hang at the top of your window. Sometimes you'll have panels underneath it and sometimes you won't. Bill, can you scan the camera over here to this one on the side, or should I just pick this up?
Hold on a second.
So over here to my left, it's gonna be the right for you guys. You can see this is a cornice board. Oh, he's gonna pop it over in a second. This is a cornice board that's going to be just like this one, and I started it just so you guys could get an idea of what a cornice board looked like. So that's the way it's going to be upholstered with that fabric. So we're going to do all of that with this one, and we're going to add a cording around the top and then a top cap, which you'll see, and that'll finish up the cornice board. Now let's talk a little bit about cornice board construction, because obviously this one's already built. This is actually a recover. So we had these cornice boards in our bedroom. And they actually had a scalloped bottom. They had a black floral fabric. If you're on Facebook, you might have seen a picture I posted a few days ago with that on there. And I decided I want to change up. I've got a bedding class coming the end of the month. I'm hosting Donna Cash from Designs by Donna. And so when I decided to do bedding, I picked out fabrics that didn't go with the existing cornices, and it just kind of snowballed into, let's redo the bedroom. So we took the scalloped bottom off of this, so we had to strip everything down. Bill took a, what do you call it, Bill, skill saw?
Yep.
Skill saw, and cut the bottom of this off because it really did have a lot of details. It kind of dipped in the middle and then it had little points on the side. But now let's get into what these little babies are made out of. So I cover my pieces with my lining fabric to line the inside prior to putting the frames together. Not everybody does that when they do cornice boards. Some people will put the lining on the interior. Let me get this, I'm getting stuck here. After it's built. I prefer to do it before. I think I actually learned that, if I remember correctly. Give a shout out to Scott Robbins, who used to travel around the country teaching window treatment classes. And I believe he is the one that I had taken a class for, and he did it this way, and I just love this method. So, each piece is upholstered with the lining, so it'll be exposed on the inside of the frame before it's built. Now the top and the sides of this are made with 1x6s, and the depth of your cornice board is really determined by the area that you're using it in and what else is going on in your window. Our window, we live in a Victorian house that was built in the 1800s, and it has really thick, deep woodwork around the windows. So I needed extra depth for that, and then I also have shears hung under this, and that's mounted under there too. So I needed to bring this out from the wall 5.5 inches in order to get the depth to accommodate for everything going on underneath. So I used 1x6s. Oftentimes, if you don't have anything other than maybe an inside mount shade of some sort, you'll see them with just like a 3.5 return or depth. So the return is the distance it projects away from the wall. So when you hear that terminology, you'll understand that. And the legs are also made out of the 1x6s. So these are called your legs, and this is called your cap, I believe it. Some people call them different things. I call it your cap. And then the front of our cornice board, which is the part here, is made out of a 1/2 inch plywood. You can make them out of 1/4 inch plywood. I wouldn't suggest going heavier than 1/2 inch just because of the weight hanging them and getting them up there, especially if you're going to be hanging them alone. But it is always a good idea to have somebody who knows what they're doing hang cornice boards for you if you don't know what you're doing, because you don't want these things to come down, especially if they're over your bed in the middle of the night. You don't want things crashing on your head. Bill's looking at me because we've probably had things come down, I'm sure.
Well, I dropped that one when I took it off the wall.
Oh, did you? I wasn't home when you took them down for me. So there you go. Survived the crash test, too.
It probably weighs 15 pounds.
Yeah, they're not light, I mean, but they're as light as we can make them. There is a product, and if anybody's out there watching, I see we've got several of you on YouTube. So Sandra Van Sickle is out there. So Sandra, if you can remember, because I am like having a senior moment here, what the product is that Rolly Company sells that you can use for cornice boards that is not plywood. I want to say it's called fiberboard or something, but I can't remember. But post that out there if you wouldn't mind, Sandra, on YouTube for us. So let's see. I see Susan is here, and Muhammad is here, and Sandra is here, and June, and Katrina, and Sherry, and let's see. Muhammad says, I share the same profession with you. Awesome, Muhammad. I think that's it. Okay, so that's, I think I got everybody, so I hope I didn't miss any questions. But anyway, so yeah, there is a product that you can do that makes them lighter. I've never used it. I've seen it and feel it, but I'm a wood girl, so when it comes to these, I use the plywood, but there are other products you can use. Now for the cornice boards too, you want them padded so they're on the soft side, but you don't want them, well, maybe you do. It depends on your situation and what you're going for a look. You don't really typically make them poofy. I'm going to be using a half layer of Dacron to pad our cornice board. So I use 1 ounce Dacron, which is about an inch thick when it's not split in two. And I actually split the layers in half so that it's a half a thickness. So instead of being a full ounce, it's now a half ounce or thereabouts. And we are going to staple this to the front of our cornice boards. And then I've got pieces that I'll staple individually on the legs because my roll is only 54 inches wide. And I think I needed 60 something to go around this cornice board. Now the other thing you want to be careful of when you're doing cornice boards is you want to make sure you're not using staples that are so long that they're going to go through the lumber that you're using and be sticking out on the backside. Because when you're working with the fabric and stuff, you're apt to catch your fingers on there. I mean, once they're up in the window, nobody's touching them, but it's just a good idea to make sure your staples are short enough that they stay in the wood thickness that you have. So I'm using my Sailrite gun, and I don't really need a long nose for this type of project, but I prefer to use a long nose, so that's what we're going to use. So let's go ahead and put a few staples to hold this. And I don't know if I said to line these, I just use a lining fabric, or you can also use a muslin. I'm stapling my Dacron along the front edge, which I'll turn around for you, so that when I pull my fabric, it will just skim over the edge of the cornice board. I'm not putting cording on the bottom of my cornice board for this particular project, but sometimes you'll see that on the bottom, but I am putting it on the top. All right, so now that that's held in place, I'm gonna go ahead and trim it down. Does it get a little bit of excess going on here?
So Sherry says that the Rolly product is Firmaflex.
Firmaflex, thank you, Sherry. Yeah, I just could not for the life of me think of the name there for a minute. But Firmaflex is much lighter weight, so if you've got huge cornice boards, that's a good option. And if you need instructions with building cornice boards, Sandra Van Sickle, actually, who's out there live with Sandra V, actually has a tutorial that is actually available on our website on how to build a cornice board and upholstery, and she shows you how to add banding to them as well. But she does hers a little different than I do. There's so many ways, different ways to do cornice boards, that there's so many ways to do anything, really. I mean, even upholstery, you'll see upholsterers doing things not exactly the same way as another one, and you get the same results in the end. So you just gotta find what method works good for you. Good to know all the different methods, because oftentimes you can pick up little things from each person's techniques and you come up with your own way of doing stuff. So let me just spin this a second so you can see the stuff on the front, and then we'll get the legs covered. Now we have three of these for our room that I need to do. So there you can see with the front. So the Dacron, when I pull my fabric down, will just skim the edge and give a nice soft edge to the front of my cornice board. And then at the top, we'll have our cording, which will give it a nice crisp finish. So let's go ahead and add the Dacron to the two ends. And I had some scraps that I know are extra wide, but Had some scraps laying around that were perfect for doing this. And you don't need a ton of staples for the Dacron. And some people have padded their cornice boards with foam. Use a 1-inch foam or 1/2-inch foam. It really depends on the look you're going for. Oops, I think I totally missed there. Yes, I'm not sure what was up with Facebook, but it would not let us go live there today, so. Actually, if some of you wouldn't mind, I don't know if Facebook's working now. If you could copy the link from this and share it on Facebook for us so that people know we're over here, that would be awesome. And you can share on Twitter, Instagram, wherever you can share too for your social media would be fun. So what projects are any of you working on out there? I know Sandra just got back from teaching at IWCE, so I'm sure she's trying to get back into workroom mode. All right, what did I do with that other piece? Stuck it on the inside.
I wonder if anybody caught that. Sandra did an awesome job of broadcasting from IWCE.
Yeah. If you follow Live with Sandra V on Facebook, she did an awesome job telecasting from the IWCE, which is the International Window Coverings Expo, and interviewing the vendors in the vendor hall. It was really great if you couldn't be there to see what was going on and see all the different vendors that were there. And they were estimating that there were about a couple thousand people at that conference, which is totally, totally awesome. And I think next year I'm putting that one on my calendar. This year it just did not fit because I'm leaving tomorrow for California, and they just got back from, where was it? Nashville, right? Nashville, Tennessee, from the conference. Next year it is in Charlotte, North Carolina, I think you said, Sandra? I think that's what I saw on that sign. And it'll be the end of March next year. So I'm just stapling close to the edge. And then just trimming it off. Oops. Almost trimmed that off too short there for a second. I'll move this in a second so you can see it all padded up here. And then we'll be ready for fabric. I'm loving this fabric too. Let me shift this so that you can see. Let's see. Which camera are we at? That one. So I've just put pieces along the edge, and I made sure that it came up out to where the front Dacron ended so that I don't have a void there and have a sharp corner that's exposed. So now the next thing for my project.
Again, would you please?
Yes, I would.
My camera didn't switch when I was
Sorry. So there you go. There's the end. And what I did is I made the side pieces come out so they're flush with their, where the Dacron ended on the front, so that I don't have a void in the corner there. So I didn't want to feel any wood. Not that anybody's going to be touching your window treatments, but you know, you want to do things the right way. Now when I was playing with this fabric, and I don't know if you guys do this, it's a good suggestion if you don't. Sometimes you're trying to figure out how to lay out a print on a piece of, you know, a piece of furniture or on something like this. Let's see, I don't want to get my pieces confused. Here it is. So what I did is I have the roll on the table. And if you look at this, it's got this larger, let's see if I can do this. It's got this larger, whatever you want to call it, going on there. And then it's got this row of smaller ones. And at first, my first thought was that I wanted to center the larger one in the middle of the headboard, both horizontally and vertical. And then I was looking at centering the row with the smaller ones, and I'm just like, you know, I really don't know. So what I did is I laid my fabric out on the table, and actually, if I can find the pictures, I'll show you. What I did is I laid rulers out so that I framed out what the look was going to be, and took pictures of them, and that really helped me determine which way to place the fabric. So you can see that's the picture with the small one centered in the center, and you can see the two silver rulers. And then this is the one with the big one, the big part of the design centered in the center. Now, if you look at those, see if I can swipe them. So if you look at that one, the other way, I think my finger's bothering me. There, whoops, wrong way. And then you look at that one. I liked that one more because I had two complete repeats of that larger pattern. Let's see if I can sweep it again. Oops. So see the difference? And I liked the larger, I can't get my fingers to go right. I really liked this way better, so that's the way I ended up centering it. So I centered the small design versus the big design. And it's one of those things that my instinct was to go with this larger medallion. And had I not laid that out and played with it on the table and just gone for it, I would have never known what the other one looked like. And the other one really looked to me to be the better. And I'll oftentimes do the same thing when I'm upholstering a piece of furniture or making a pillow. I'll frame it out with rulers or stuff and take pictures, because I find if you've got it laid out on the table, you've got the rulers framing it, your eyes are still going crazy seeing the rest of the pattern and you're not really seeing how it reads. So making sure that you see how it reads before you get it on your project, whether it's a window treatment, a pillow, or a sofa or a chair, is always a good idea. Now the other thing I've done right here is I've marked the center, and I don't know if you can see there's a notch right there, but I've marked the center of my fabric piece, top and bottom. I've got a notch on both ends, and then I also, because I determined this was the top by the way I wanted to lay out the pattern, I've made myself just a little yellow T with my tailor's chalk so that I wouldn't get confused and put this on the bottom of my cornice. Now let me stand this up. And I've marked the center of the top of my cornice board. So I've got a little line here that matches up with a notch, and I need to stick a couple staples here. I missed this edge. So let me do that before we get the fabric on here. Okay. So when you get ready to do your fabric, and I also determined that out of these two, let's see if where you are here, out of these two lines right here, the way I planned the cornice board, the top of the cornice board will be on the back side of this solid line. So those two solid, they're not really solid lines, but those two bands of lines there will be at the top of my cornice board. And again, I played around with that with the ruler, and centering that other piece made this happen perfect. So I really liked that look. So now let's take the center of our fabric, center of our cornice board, and knowing that I want those lines to be right along the top edge, we'll get staples. We got things falling behind the camera. It's gonna be one of those days. I think it's gonna be one of those years. Wednesday seems to be a curse with our lives between what's happening in our lives and Facebook today. It's like crazy. Oops, you know what? Okay, I take this bracelet off. It's getting hooked on the fabric. It keeps getting hooked underneath here. So I'm just making sure that part of the motif is where I want it on the edge of the frame. Sometimes what I'll do, because this was a recover and it's already covered with fabric, I didn't bother to try to do this, but sometimes what I'll do is I'll measure and see what's this distance where I'm trying to place this on the front of the board, and I'll actually make myself a line on the top of the corners. In fact, I don't know if you can, you're not on the right camera, but you can see there's lines from the last time I did this. And then that way you're not constantly guessing and tweaking. You've got a line, you slap it down and get it all attached. So I've got the center held on, so now I'm gonna go over here to one side and pull it taut, not to distort, but just to keep it taut. And I'm gonna get a staple here towards the outer edge. Now I'm gonna work my way down from the center, because I've got it tight already. Just making sure I'm keeping it in the right location, top to bottom. And don't go filling it in with a ton of staples as you get started, because you might need to tweak something. You might decide you changed your mind on where it's positioned and you want to come back and shift something. So just good enough to get you started, get it held in place, and then fill it in when you're not, you know, when you know and you're confident with it, what your choices were. And watch when you're pulling too, because if you start pulling your grain off, then when you go to do the bottom and attach everything in, you're going to end up just seeing that it's off and you're going to have to make major adjustments. So
here, that looks like it's hanging down lower on the end. I'm not sure if it's a conclusion or what.
Yeah. Oh, it is. You know what? I did go down there. You are right. Mr. Eagle Eyes there. How's that? I don't think I had the corner stapled before I was doing that.
No, I don't know. I almost think you've got to pull your center down and get it attached at the bottom somewhere. So
okay. All right, so we'll leave it where it is right now, and we'll get some in the bottom, which was my next move anyway. So let's go ahead and do that. So now I'm going to have it back to you so I can see what's going on, because first I've also marked my center. I thought I marked my center. There it is right there. Mark it down a little further because I'm gonna not be able to see it once I start pulling the fabric. So again, I'm gonna line my center up. And if I planned this just right, let me see, how did I do this on the other one here? Oops. Okay, so I pulled it so that line was on the bottom. All right. There's my center. And my staple gun's way over there. How many times have you done that?
I think you should have stayed in bed this morning.
Now, tomorrow I leave for California, and my flight is at 6:15, so I have to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning, or 2:30, so that I can be out the door by 3:30. So I probably should have stayed in bed. All right, so the part of the motif show you in a second. Which camera? Can you put them on the other camera, Bill, so they can see?
Which one is
the overhead, sorry. So what I did, if you see the, when I'm pulling here, if I move my hand a little bit, what I did is I planned it so when I pull, this dark line is actually on the bottom of the cornice board, and like I said, I'm not putting cording on here, so I just thought that would be a nice finish. Oops, and that staple doesn't go there. It goes way back here. So I've got to gently pop that staple out because that's going to be exposed. So let's just get a few more done here. And using your hands to smooth the fabric up and get the tautness you need is always very helpful. So we'll go this way a little bit, and then we'll go the other way a little bit, and then we'll stand it up and take a look. And because it's not going to be attached everywhere, it's going to have some dips when you first get started here. And I've got a table straddled over the top of the pedestal because I needed a little bit more width than the pedestal has. And so you hear me keep dropping my off the edge of the table onto the pedestal here. One or two more this direction, and then we'll go the other way. And you want to make sure you bring your fabric up far enough on the inside that you don't end up seeing the lining on the corners when it's hung in a window. Ask me how I know. I did that once and got to a client's house, got it all hung up, and was like, oh, nuts. You could see just like 2 inches of lining fabric here. So I learned my lesson. It's hung up in the window. You're below it. So okay, now let's go the other way for a little bit. And then I'll come back and take that staple out. If I wasn't on camera trying to make sure you guys can see everything, I'd probably be in a little bit more comfortable position doing this, but you just want to make sure that you can get the grip you need and see what you need to see. too far. Pop out this oops staple. And hopefully without tearing my fabric. Yay! Perfect. Stand it up before I do the ends. You guys can see it from the front. Ooh, it goes a little wonky on camera, doesn't it? That's a technical term. So then these will be brought around the sides. It's hard for me to tell from back here looking at the image that you guys see, but I think it looks straight up and down. What do you think? And don't look at the ends, Bill, because they're not attached.
That's pretty good.
Okay. All right, so you always want to check your work as you go, and it's best if you can actually stand back at least like 5 or 6 feet. If you're looking right at it from close up, you're not seeing everything, but if you stand back, you'll see things that you can't see when you're on top of it. And if you ever want opinion on something, send a picture to Bill, because he has an eye that can see a 16th of an inch, and it drives me crazy. But it's good to have. I can't see it sometimes. I'm like, really? It's like, yep, it's crooked. So, all right. So now I'm going to lay it down on its face because we need to pull the ends up and around. Now this fabric is seamed, and the seam just barely goes around the corner on this cornice board. The other two windows are smaller, so the seam is down the center. But you do want to always match your pattern. So the pattern is matched on these end seams. And when you're doing, I'll have to see what Sandra thinks on this, but when I do this and have to have a seam, I have the seam face towards the front of the cornice board, because I find then when you're looking down the side of the cornice board, you don't see a ridge where the seam line is. It just kind of disappears into the wall. But if you fold your seam back away from the face of the cornice board, you end up seeing that stitch line more prominently. So I would play around with your fabrics, because some fabrics might behave differently. You could also press it open if you want to do that, but I like it flipped towards the front, and I find that works good. When I've had like heavy tapestry fabrics that I've done cornice boards out, I think I have split those and folded the seams both ways because of the extra thickness. So it's just something to think about and consider when you're working on your project what you want. Now I'm just looking at how tight I want this. So what I'm kind of doing is looking at where the pattern lands so that I can have a straight line. Would be just make your lives a little simpler. So I'm going to end up having to bump that in a little bit. I think it's going to look good. I think it's tight enough too. So now what I'm going to do is put some temporary staples along this edge, because that's where it gets finished. So I want to get it pulled up taut, get some temporary staples holding it there, and then get the rest of this finished before I trim and fold over and actually finish off those edges. But I want it held in place for me. And keeping that line along the top edge as well. So you get lots to pay attention to when you're working with a printed fabric. Okay, so there's my top edge. Actually line it up on the outside edge. Because if you can have a straight line to work with, it's always easier to have something to focus on to make sure everything's nice and straight. And again, just putting temporary staples in here, because we'll be switching these out to give a finished edge. Now some people pull their fabrics all the way to the inside and finish it off in there, but I finish it off on the back edge of my legs. Now, I don't know how many of you have been following our Facebook page or in our DIY group, but another one of our members has just launched her website, which is totally awesome. Her business is Sophisticated Upholstery, and she is out of Idaho. She actually moved her business from California to Idaho. Oops, I need staples. To Idaho, and she is busy already, and she's only been there, what, a couple months maybe ago? If that. So if you check out her website. We were having a conversation in our Q&A last week about websites and stuff, and she's like, oh, I looked a while ago and the domain wasn't available, and you know, we were all saying, figure out a domain you want, and even though you're not ready to do your website, buy your domain name. So she looked while we were all online during the Q&A, and she's like, it's available, and she went and bought it right then and there. And she now launched a beautiful website, so you can go check her out at Sophisticated, spelled S-E-W, .com. All right, now let's go to the other end, do the same thing, and then I'll come back and do this inside edge here. Again, seam towards the front. So Sandra, which way do you fold your seams if you have to have a seam in your cornice board? Do you split them? Do you fold in one direction? Okay, which part of the design did I use? I already forgot. Here is that part, and it's the inside one. Way up here. So I'm going to get one temporary symbol right here. Sandra said Bill on YouTube. What she does. Because I know that everybody's got different thoughts on that. And one thing that you'll find, I don't want to give you guys my back of my hand here, but if you come into this as a window treatment person versus an upholsterer, you'll handle these things a lot different. In fact, we had a situation where somebody's working on a headboard and they're thinking, you know, they approached it thinking like they would for a window because that's what their background is. And then there's something they came across that they hadn't thought of. So really, if it's got wood and it's got a frame that you're attaching fabric to, even if it's a window treatment or a headboard, you gotta think about it as upholstery. Because it's definitely, there's different ways to approach it, and you'll make your life easier if you think of it in terms of that. A few staples to fold it. I'm also watching my stitch line to make sure I'm pulling it consistently. You don't want any wonky stitch lines. You know the feeling when you have one side of the furniture you can hang on to easier? Well, that's where I am right now. This is the harder side to hang on to and staple. Should be ready to finish the bottom. Okay, so now, see, I think I'll leave it laying down maybe. Now I'm gonna go ahead, now I think I need to stand it up. Okay. Now again, I'm gonna watch that line that I'm using to make sure I'm keeping it nice and straight. Deal with the corner here. That looks good. And then at the top here, because the leg is thicker than the plywood, I need to make a fold. Well, I need to make a fold anyway. But I'm going to fold it so that the opening is aiming towards the leg instead of into the room. You always want to keep in mind when you're doing anything, whether it's a piece of furniture, window treatment, slipcover, what part is going to project into the room and how do you want that to look. So handy dandy regulator, yes, can be used on window treatments. You know what, I didn't pull this up far enough now that I realize that. Let me undo this side, I gotta pull it up just a little bit more, today. For some reason it's fighting me here. Let's see, I know it worked on the other one, so I'm just not pulling hard enough, but I actually have a staple from my Dacron poking out too. So let's fix that. And this is why you don't put a whole bunch of staples in all at once. I want to open up here a little bit because there's a staple back here. Unless I can, I don't know why one end of it's poking out. I don't want it to come through the fabric later on. So what's everybody working on? I'm excited to be heading out to warmer weathers, although it's finally starting to warm up here.
Hans recovering an ottoman.
Uh-huh. What kind of an ottoman? Do you have a pillow top ottoman or ottoman with a skirt, no skirt? Okay, so yeah, there was an end of a staple, just it didn't go all the way into the wood and it was poking out. It was gonna end up not being nice to my fabric, so. I think I'm going to have to release some of these so I can pull this up a little further, but let's go ahead and get that end going and then I'll come back and do this. Because I don't want to run out of time and have you. I can't tell what time it is. We haven't changed our clock, Bill. Is it really almost 1:30?
Yep, 20 after. You have 8 minutes. 8 minutes to the bell.
Ew, meow. All right, yeah, so I've just got that pulled too tight back here and I had it shifted down, so I need to shift it up because this side's working just fine. So what I want to do is just get this down so we can finish off our corner. Leg down first. And then do the inside to work this corner. But your regulator will come in really handy for this too. So I end up using both ends oftentimes, so tuck the corner with that end and then sharpen the corners, pulling the fabric with the sharp point end. I get this stapled a little closer to the corner before I finesse that a little bit more.
Andrea's making Roman shades.
Aha! I've actually got to make some Roman shades for our cutting room. So what head rail system are you using, Andrea, for your Roman shades? With all the new products out there. Sandra just went over at IWCE. She just went over, I think, 8 different systems. There are so many systems available and so many different variations now. But you gotta make them safe. You don't wanna see any children getting injured.
Hello, Marie. Thanks for joining.
Hello, Marie.
Maria, I'm sorry.
Maria. Yeah, I see it. Let's get this fold a little better here. And it really is just tweaking the fabric, but you don't want this funny lump happening there, so. Need to get it to fold a little bit deeper. There we go. I think what I'm actually going to do is pull this back and use a staple to keep this part taut so I'm not cutting both pieces at the same time, because that staple will be hidden in my fold. Smoothed it out. Now down on the insides, you want to keep it as neat looking as you want. Now all this will be covered up. I'll put a decorative trim and I'll make sure my staples are all nice and straight when I'm finished. I'll probably have to adjust some of them. And then a decorative trim will cover the staple work. I think I am going to have to pop a couple here to pull this up a little bit more on the end. There we go. See how nice that just popped up once I let that go? Which is what I'm going to do on that other side. Alright, so now, which camera are you guys on? They kind of need to see along here too, Bill. When I'm doing furniture, Bill knows exactly what you guys need, but when I'm doing cornice boards, it's not something we do all the time, so. So now what I'm gonna do is staple this part along here, and then we'll trim out the excess, and then we'll be able to finesse and finish our edges. Let's see if I go like this. Just trying to decide what's the best way to finish this off. Yeah, I don't like that, I like this better. All right, so now I'm just getting all the rest of this out of my way. I'm pulling this around just so I get a nice crisp line. Now I would also suggest, if you've got a way to clamp these things to hold them still while you're working on them, that's always a plus. I'm gonna trim this off. Make sure I don't cut the front fabric. I got extra, but we still don't want to have to do that. I'm not going all the way to the edge because I need to adjust this little corner here. So then I'm going to cut out. So this is just like when you're upholstering a piece of furniture. You're cutting out the excess bulk. So that's why you approach these, because they're upholstered. They're approached like upholstery. And that will be what our finish looks like. So what I'm going to do is get one staple in here, and then we'll cut out a little more excess. And those hidden little staples are things that can make your life so easy, or so much easier, when you're trying to finesse something and finish it off. So looking at this, if I cut following this line out here, that should give me enough to fold and do what I need to do. So let me cross in front of you guys. So we'll go down partway. And then I'll go ahead and fold this under. Because even though this is going to be against the wall and not show, I always want it to look as neat as I possibly can. That's the perfectionist in me that has to like have everything have finished look. And I know I'm not the only one that thinks that way, so. Here. All right, so now that I've got this part done, I'm going to go ahead and lay it down to do the rest of this, and then we'll finish that other end next week and add our dust cap to the top with our cording. There will be a part.
Won't be next week.
Won't be next week, that's right, because I will be in the air flying home from California, so it'll be the week after. So March 27th, if my calendar in my head works. actually, you know what? When we're Donna Cash will be here March 27th, and I'm not sure what time she's arriving, so we may have to switch up our live or not do a live, do it at a different, maybe Donna and I will do a project together live. How would that be? We'll have to see what time she gets in and how she feels.
Yeah, she may not want
to. I'll let you guys know. Yeah, she's coming in on the 27th, so that her and I have a play day on Thursday before class starts on Friday. Bill's going to be like, oh, two creatives in the workroom at the same time. Do you remember the day, Bill, that we had Sandra, Donna, and I all here? He's back there. You guys can't see him, but you can't see me either. You're seeing the board, but he's back there with his lips going, oh. But yeah, Donna and Sandra and I, Sandra, I think you're still out there watching. We had every scrap of fabric I could possibly have in my show, my sewing room out on the table, and we were throwing around ideas, and it was like Sandra calls it spaghetti head. So it was like Donna would say, hey, we can take this fabric and we can make a pocketbook. And Sandra's like, yeah, but we can take this fabric and we can make a whatever. And I'm like, but this fabric over here would make a great blah, blah, blah. And it was like that all afternoon with the three of us. It was pretty comical, but it was a blast. We had so much fun. We made tassels and we made pocketbooks. We'll have to do that again sometime, Sandra. We had so much fun. And Ken and Bill, Ken is Sandra's husband, just kind of left the room and went and did their own thing. They're like, yeah, you guys have at it. We don't need to be in on this. So you can see I'm folding the raw edges under and making sure that it's nice and straight, and I'm following the pattern, the line of the motif along the edge of the frame here. My staples are probably about a finger's width apart. Some of them are a little bit further. And you also, when you're doing this, you want to watch your stitch line to make sure everything's straight there. Now let's stand it up, show you that, excuse me, the end in a second here. I see one adjustment that I've got to make to get this line perfectly straight, but if you could put it on the front camera, Bill. So there is the corner of our cornice board, and I don't think you can see that seam on camera, but it is right here, is the stitch line where I match the pattern up. Oh, there you can, now you can see it. So, yeah, you can't see the seam. See, that's because I matched it really well. So right here, it's in this motif. It matches in the center of those little X's that you see. And you can see how it comes around the corner really nicely there. All right, let's go ahead and I will finish the top off here on this end. And then I'll go back. Now you can see in the front probably where it's not full tight everywhere. I'll go back and fill it all in, and then we'll adjust that edge next week. Or maybe I'll get it adjusted before next week so we can start off with it in the right place. And you always want to think when you're making your pleats and stuff, like I said, what's the next step that's happening in a project that you're working on, whether it's furniture or cornice boards, and so that you know when you're making those moves that you know what's going to happen next, you know you're going to be able to hide it or how it's going to appear. So I thank all of you for being patient with us this afternoon. Sorry we got in late due to technology out there, but we hope you enjoyed this week's live. Stay tuned for tons and tons of pictures from California, because I am not only teaching a 3-day small chair upholstery workshop at the home of Mary Ann Henderson, or the studio of Mary Ann Henderson in Lodi, California, but I'm leaving Lodi, California on Sunday night, and I'm headed down to San Diego to spend 2 days with a new friend who I've met online, who is Louise Kronick, who I'm sure you've seen out there, and she is the woman who runs the Upholstery Education website. So stay tuned for lots and lots of images of my adventures in California and our 3-day workshop. And Deanna, I can't wait to meet you in person, and you, Marianne, as well. And Teresa's gonna be there, and Karen, and Pat, and Kathleen. So all of you, I get to meet you in person for the first time. So thanks everybody for joining us today, and stay tuned for photos, and we'll see you in a couple weeks.